The quaternion is not very useful for gaining intuition into an orientation of an aircraft. If you just look at the numbers within the four component quaternion, it's really difficult to visualize the orientation of the aircraft. And so it's really helpful to be able to convert between the quaternion and other attitude descriptors. So we're going to talk about two of those. And the first one we're going to talk about here is converting a quaternion to Euler angles or vice versa. So the way we're going to do that is to recognize that when we work through the Euler angle development, we were able to come up with some vector in body fixed coordinates that was equal to some transformation matrix that had nine components in it, multiplied by a vector in Earth fixed coordinates. Okay, so we went over that previously, and we also came up with something very similar for quaternions. We had some transformation matrix again that would take something from a vector in Earth fixed coordinates to body fixed coordinates, and of course the transpose of either of these matrices would then take you back from body fixed to earth fixed. Okay, so these two matrices looked like this. So these were our two transformation matrices, and so the one on the left here, this is the quaternion transformation matrix. If we have quaternions, we plug it in here and can go from earth fixed to body fixed. And if we are using Euler angles, this is the transformation matrix that we would plug into this equation here. So each of these are nine component matrices that are our transformation matrix. And so one way to solve the relationship between these two is simply to set these two matrices equal to each other, and then work through the math to solve for Euler angles as a function of quaternions, or quaternions as a function of Euler angles. So I'm not going to go through the math. It's actually fairly involved. You equate the different components of these matrices, and work through and use trigonometric identities. And anyway, there's a bit that goes into this, but eventually, what you come out with is this here for the quaternions. If you solve for trying to find the quaternion as a function of the Euler angles, okay? So this works really well. What you notice is that there's actually two solutions here. If you have a set of Euler angles, there's actually two different quaternions that will satisfy this equation, and so there's a plus or minus. So that means, let's say that E naught was positive, or let's see that all of these were positive. Well, you could also represent the same orientation if all of these were negative, if these were all the opposite sign. And the reason that that makes sense is because if you remember, the Euler, or excuse me, quaternions come from the Euler axis formulation, which is which, if I draw again this really quickly, so x, y, and z, and then we have some Euler axis, and then a rotation, a right-handed rotation around that axis. Well, this orientation could be equally described if we flipped the sign of the axis, meaning that it pointed in the opposite direction, and we flipped the sign of the rotation in the opposite direction. Then it would actually create the exact same orientation. So you can flip the sign on, if you flip the sign on all of these, it creates the same rotation. So it's basically saying a positive rotation about a positive axis is equal to a negative rotation about a negative axis. Anyway, so there's two solutions, but usually what we use is the positive value here. So I'll just circle that there. That's usually what is used here to define the quaternion as a function of the Euler angles. Okay. All right, so this is an important equation here that we'll want to remember and employ in a flight simulator if we wanted. For example, often for the initial conditions of an aircraft, we'll be given the Euler angles, we'll be given some bank angle and heading and azimuth, that is the same thing, the azimuth angle and heading, and then and an elevation angle. So anyway, if we were given these Euler angles as our initial conditions, then we can use this this relationship here to compute the quaternion for the initial conditions of the aircraft. And then we would integrate forward in time using the quaternion like we've discussed already. And then throughout the flight, we probably want to update information for the user, for the pilot, for the graphical user interface of the flight simulator in terms of Euler angles. So now we need to work through this again, but solve for the Euler angles as a function of quaternions instead of the quaternions and function as a function of Euler angles. So you can do that. And again, I'm not going to work through the math on that. I'm just going to show what the solution is here. And this is what you get. So I'll put this right up here. So this is the general solution for the Euler angles as a function of the quaternions. So anyway, this should be pretty straightforward. I think I'm missing an equal sign here. Let me just draw that in. So this should be equal to, okay. So this works really well, except that there's a special case here that we need to handle. And that is that when, remember gimbal lock happens when theta is at plus or minus 90 degrees. So let's just write that down here. So gimbal lock happens at theta equals plus or minus, and that's pi halves, okay? So when theta is plus or minus pi halves, actually what happens is this arctangent, and by the way, the A-tan 2, the reason you use A-tan 2 is it preserves the quadrant, so we're going to pass in two values to that function, and that will preserve the quadrant. What we're getting out of that is an angle, right? But when we're in gimbal lock and theta is at plus or minus pi halves, it turns out that this is indeterminate. You get a 0, 0, or a tangent of a 0 divided by 0. And so that obviously causes some problems here. So what we need to do is handle the special case when we're in gimbal lock. And so one way to do that is with this set of equations here. So in general, we would use this set of equations here, but if, and this is the definition of gimbal lock, so we'll hit gimbal lock if the quaternion, these components are equal to 0.5 or these components are equal to negative 0.5, then we'll be in gimbal lock. And there's two different ways to handle that. So what happens is when we're in gimbal lock, that means that the nose of the aircraft is pointed directly up. Okay, or down, right? So directly up or directly down. And when that happens, the bank angle then depends on the heading of the aircraft. So you can see if you work through the equations right at gimbal lock, then you can see that the bank angle depends on the heading of the aircraft. So you've got a plus heading there and a minus heading there, depending on if the nose is up or down, okay? So, and we know what theta is. So when the nose is up, then theta is at pi halves. When the nose is down, and this is the quaternion for when the nose is pointed directly down, then theta is at minus pi halves, okay? So when we're up or down, or nose straight up or straight down, that means that our bank angle now depends on what we consider our heading to be. And our heading is actually arbitrary. This is very similar so if you look at the Earth here, so I'm just going to try to draw latitude and longitude lines along the Earth. So this is similar to being at the north or south pole, and then trying to specify a longitude. Well, longitude is irrelevant. If you're at the North or South Pole, meaning that your latitude puts you, you know, all the way at the North or South Pole, then longitude is really irrelevant. You can choose anything you want because you're actually at all of the longitudes. You know, you take a step in any direction, you can be at any longitude you want. So longitude is really irrelevant when your latitude is at the North Pole or the South Pole, okay? So this is a similar type of thing here. What we're saying is our heading is really arbitrary if our nose is pointed straight up or straight down. And so we can choose anything that really makes sense. But once we choose something, that will determine what our bank angle is, because we've chosen some heading then that feeds into that bank angle, okay? Okay, so this is the algorithm. Really, it's a combination of both of these equations here. So in general, of course, this equation holds, and that's for any point outside of gimbal lock. But when we are at gimbal lock, and we test that by testing our quaternion to see if this is true or if this is true, if our nose is straight up or straight down. And the way we test that is by looking at this quaternion to see if our nose is straight up or straight down. And if that's the case, then we need to apply, we'll need to choose a heading, which in my code, I believe I usually just use my most recent heading. I just reuse that. That's the most recent information about that for the heading of the aircraft. So I just plug that in, and then that will specify the bank angle. And usually you pass through this orientation really rapidly. You know, this is not usually an orientation that is held for very long. So these two these statements here are really only executed at a really minute times in the integration process. Most of the time we're executing on this equation here.